Good morning. Welcome to the third session on timers and serial port peripherals of 8051. In the last few sessions, we have covered the 8051 timers and counter structure, their operation, and the ALP to generate a pulse using mode 1. So just let us briefly recap. Along with the pulse, we also have generated a square wave using the 8051 in mode 1. So a brief recap. Let us say we have to generate a square wave with on time of 3 milliseconds and the off time of 10 milliseconds. In this, first we have to calculate the T on for 3 milliseconds, what should be loaded, the count in. So the count in is a 3 milli and divide into the crystal frequency. The crystal frequency is 22 megahertz divided by 12. This is your count in to count 3 milliseconds. So the timer register values depends on the max value. Here we are assuming mode 1 and the max value will be 2 to the power 16. That is 65,536 minus 5,500. So it gives me the TH1 and TL1 values. Similarly, for 10 milliseconds, you find the TH1 and TL1 values and also the T mode register. So three registers we have to find. One is the THTL, the timer register's initial value. Then the mod value, that in T mod, the mod value in T mod. And for the mod value in T mode, we have the timer, bits, that is the last four bits of a timer zero. And the top four bits are for timer one. And substituting M0, M1, since we are using timer one, substituting M0, M1 as 01. And timer mode zero, no gate, so zero, it is 10. That's a T mode. So we have the program for the square wave with the 3 milliseconds on time and off time. So initially we have to make the port pin high. So in this we are using all the pins of port zero. So making all the port pins zero, I have to say move P0 with FF. So all the port pins are made high. And after it is high, we have to give a 3 milliseconds delay. So for 3 milliseconds delay, the initial value is loaded. So it is calculated as EA84. EA is in TH1 and 84 is in TL1. And then we have to start the timer. To start the timer, we have to make TR1 equal to 1. That in assembly level language, it is set. Set the bit TR1. And then you keep waiting till the timer becomes from FF, it will roll to 0. For that, we have to keep checking the TF1 flag. The TF1 flag is the timer flag. Initially, it is 0. And once a timer rolls over, immediately TF becomes 1. As soon as the timer flag becomes 1, you go to the next instruction where we stop the timer, make TR1 equal to 0, clear the TF so that the next timing operation is enabled. So we have finished the first top portion, that is 3 milliseconds. Next, to get the 10 milliseconds, move the port P0 with 00. And once again, load the timer registers with the initial count, that is B863 for 10 milliseconds. Then start the timer, wait till it overflows, then stop the timer and S jump again. Again, you make it high, 3 milliseconds delay. Then start the timer, stop the timer, and then again 10 millisecond delay initial count. Then start the timer and stop the timer. Before we make it 10 milliseconds, we make the port P0 equal to 0. Here, one thing we have to observe this, we are loading the timer registers every time. So every time we need 3 milliseconds high, we are loading the initial value. Even for 10 milliseconds, we load the value. So this is required in this case. In the next case where we have the square wave generation, where T on and T off represented by T1 and T2, they are same. So it's for 50% duty cycle or a square wave with 50 kilohertz. So the total T is 20 milliseconds And for square wave, t on equal to t off, that's equal to t by 2, 10 milliseconds. And the delay that we get, the timer count that we get for 10 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds into xtal by 12, that is crystal frequency is 11 megahertz divided by 12, that is 9216. This is the timer count. And for this 9216, assuming mode 1, the initial value is DC00H. And in the program, what we do here is we load the count initially, TL1, 00, and 0DCH. Every time the counter stops, the timer finished the counting the 10 milliseconds, delaying the 10 milliseconds. What we do here is we complement the pin or we complement the port. CPL is a complement. So when we complement, if the port pin is high, so P2.3 is a pin, port pin, external pin. If it is high, it will become low and vice versa. So automatically it will be toggling from high to low and low to high. So hence a square wave is generated with 10 milliseconds on time and 10 milliseconds off time. We can still make it better if I use another mode. In mode 1, every time the counter, the timer has stopped counting, you have to reload S jump again. We have to reload the initial value. So the initial value is DC00. So we have to keep reloading the initial value and then start the timer again. So we need one mode. If as long as this is a constant, the initial value is constant, I need to have a free running timer wherein it'll complement, only complementing is needed, and I need not have to reload the initial value. That is possible in the next mode, that is mode 2. In mode 2, we have auto reload. So we are generating a square wave using mode 2 on a port pin. So why are we going for mode 2 on auto reload? So what do you mean by auto reload? We need not every time the timer S jump again, every time we need not have to reload the timer's initial value. So which is the timer's initial value? DC00. We need not have to reload the timer's initial value every time. Hence we go for using mode 2, that is a square wave using a mode 2 on a port pin. So this is a part of your next syllabus, that is generating a square wave using mode 2 on a port pin. What are the characteristics of mode 2? The characteristics of mode 2 is it's an 8-bit timer. Previously mode 1 was 16-bit timer, mode 0 was a 13-bit timer. So we are talking about mode 2. Mode 2 is an 8-bit timer. It can have maximum values of 00 to FF. So the maximum count is 256. So it can count 256 cycles. So initially, the initial value is given in TH. So it's a 16-bit timer. In a 16-bit timer, we have two registers, TH and TL. So out of the TH, TL, suppose I'm using timer 0 in mode 2. So TH0 of timer 0 should have the initial value. TL anyway, you should start with the 00. As soon as you start the timer, as soon as you give the TR here, start the timer, the initial value that is there in TH will be loaded into TL and the TL starts counting. And as soon as it overflows, whenever TF goes from FF to 00, whenever there is an overflow, the TH value is reloaded into TL. The TH is reloaded into TL. The register original value in TH remains constant. So the function of TH is just to keep a copy of the initial value. So the programmer need not, in this example, the programmer every time, S jump again, every time the TL1, TH1 were reloaded with the initial value and the timers were started. But in mode 2, you need not have to reload the initial value again and again. It will be loaded only once. So this mode 2 is an auto reload function wherein once you load TH and it will start doing the counting operation. So let us look at the programming steps, steps to program in mode 2. What are the steps to generate a time delay? Once again, TMOD. TMOD will tell, indicate which timer, whether it is timer 0 or timer 1 has to be used. And the mode bits are selected. M0, M1 bits are selected to indicate mode 2. 00 is mode 0, 01 mode 1, 10 mode 2, 11 mode 3, the 2 bits binary. Then load the TH registers with the initial count value. For the required delay, we calculate the initial value and put it in the TH register. We start the timer by using the TR, TR equal to 1. Then keep monitoring the timer flag TF using the instruction JNF, JNB, jump on no borrow. As long as TF equal to 0, keep waiting here itself. Once TF becomes 1, when TF goes high or 1, you get out of the loop because the timer has finished counting the required number of cycles and hence the required delay is generated already. So you come out of the loop. After coming out of the loop, clear the TF flag so that it can be re-enabled again. The timer is re-enabled again and go to step 4, wherein as soon as you start clear the TF flag, the timer is re-enabled again and you can go to step 4 where we again monitor the flag. We need not have to load the timer register again with the initial value. The initial value, you do it only once and that value will be reloaded again. So let us look at a program to generate a square wave. The frequency is 10 kilohertz and the pin used is 1.4. The timer that is supposed to be used is timer 0 in mode 2 and the crystal frequency that we are using is 22 kilohertz. So mode 2, this is an example of mode 2 programming wherein we are using a timer 0 with a crystal frequency of 22 kilohertz and we are generating a square wave of frequency 10 kilohertz. And the XNL pin that we are using is for D4 or the fourth pin of port 1, P1.4. What does P1.4 specify? Port 1 and the fourth pin. So the maximum value of the 8-bit timer is FF. That's an 8-bit timer. So the maximum value is FF. So before we go for this, we have to find the required delay. So the frequency is 10 kilohertz. Since the frequency is 10 kilohertz, T on equal to T off. So what's the total T? T is 1 by F, that is 1 by 10 kilohertz, that is 0.1 milliseconds. So what is T on? T on will be half of this. So that will be half of 0.1 milliseconds is 0.05 milliseconds. So we have to generate a delay of 0.05 milliseconds. So to generate a delay of 0.05 milliseconds, what is the count N? Count N as 0.05 milliseconds into the crystal frequency. The crystal frequency is 22 megahertz divided by 12. So it is 0.05 milliseconds has to be generated, the T on or the T off, and multiply by 22 megahertz, the crystal frequency divided by 12. So you get a value 92 in decimal. This is a initial value. So this is a count that has to be counted for 0.05 milliseconds. What about the initial value to be loaded into TH0? We are using timer 0, so we have to use TH0. So the initial value that has to be loaded is maximum value. So it's an 8-bit counter or timer. So the maximum value is 256. 256 minus 92. 92 is an N, so it gives me 164 in decimal. Or in converting into hex, it is A4. So the TH0 value will be 0A4. So what about the T mod? I need to know the T mod. I have finished the initial value, the TH0, the timer registration for 0.05 milliseconds. Next is the T mod. How do I choose the T mod? I'm using timer 0, the specified timer 0. So you have to use the lower 4 bits of T mod, lower 4 bits of T mod. The upper 4 bits of the T mod is dedicated to timer 1. Since we are not using timer 1, they are all don't cares. The don't cares can be replaced by 000. Generally, the don't cares are replaced by all zeros. And in timer 0, we are using mode 2. So we are using mode 2. Since we are using mode 2, M0, M1 is 10, that is mode 0. C/T bar is 0 because we are using it in the timer mode and the gate is 0. So we are not using any external control, it is only internal control. So the before we start the program, first we have to do the solution to find the initial values that have to be loaded into the timer. So to find the initial value that has to be loaded into the timer, that is the TH0 register, first I have to check how much is the delay that has to be generated, how much is the time that it should count. So to the time, it depends on what is given is a square wave of 10 kilohertz frequency. So for the square wave of 10 kilohertz frequency, what is the time period T? T equal to 1 by F, that is 1 by 10 kilohertz, that is 0.1 milliseconds. This is your complete T. And for a square wave, T on is equal to T off, that is equal to T by 2. So half of 0.1 millisecond will be 0.05 milliseconds. So your T on should be 0.05 milliseconds and your T off also should be 0.05 milliseconds. So to get 0.05 milliseconds, what I have to do is 0.05 milliseconds into crystal frequency by 12. The crystal frequency is 22 megahertz by 12. That gives me 92 in decimal. And once you get the count in, what is the initial value? Initial value will be maximum value minus n. And since we are using mode 2, the maximum value will be FF or 256. 256 minus 92. That gives me 164 in decimal, converted into hexadecimal, that is A4. So TH0 is A4. So once we have the initial values are the TMOD, which tells me which timer and which mode. So the T mode is 02, specifies timer 0 and mode 2. And next is the T on or T off that is required. Both T on is same as T off, that is 0.05 milliseconds. For this, the TH0 should be how much? 0A4H. So let us see the program now. So the program will be move T mode with the mode value. So the mode value that we have seen is 02. Move TH0 with hash A4, but actually this should be hash 0A4. Always remember the A should be preceded with A4, and then so TH0, as I said, it should be preceded with 0. So the hash 0A4H. So that is the initial value. Then TR0, start the timer, TR0 equal to 1. So for this, with the ALP is set B, set the bit TR0. So TR0 equal to 1. Then monitor the flag, TF0. So initially TF0 will be 0. And so as long as TF is 0, the microcontroller will not do anything. It will just jump to this wait. It will just jump to this wait and it will be here. It will be waiting until the TF becomes 1. When does TF becomes 1? It will become 1 when the TL0 has counted up to FF. That is, it has finished counting. And after it has finished counting, it means 0.05 milliseconds are over. Then you come out of this and here we are complementing P1.4. What do you mean by complement? Complement means we are toggling. A 1 is made 0 and a 0 is made 1. And hence a square wave is done. So if it is T on, make it pulse high and low. Then clear the timer and then SJUMP to wait. That is again, clear the timer. And remember here, in none of the places here, we have clear TR0. If I use clear TR0, you have stopped the timer. And again, you have to start the timer. Here we are not clearing the timer, we are not stopping the timer, rather we are just complementing the pin. We are complementing the pin, we are clearing the flag so that it will be set again when TL0 then, and we are SJUMPing to wait. So automatically whenever we are doing this clear TF0, TL0 is automatically doing. So we have the program wherein we have the move T mode with 02, then the initial value, then just start the timer. So once the timer is there, the timer is independent and you just monitor the flag. And as soon as the flag becomes 1, as soon as the flag becomes 1, you complement the pin, external pin on which we are generating the square wave. And we clear TF0 so that I get the next rollover. And again, clear TF0 and again wait till TF becomes 1. So once TMV comes 1, it means again, that means it has counted the next tone. So this is little extra. This is not there in your syllabus, but in the text you have as a part of this, wherein we are generating large time delays. So in your syllabus, it's clearly mentioned that you have to study only mode 1, a pulse, and mode 2, a square wave. So both we have done. Mode 1, a pulse and a square wave, and mode 2, we have generated a square wave. So this is a program to generate a square wave in mode 2 as a timer. So this is for large time delays. In all the examples that we have considered so far, the delay that we are generating is in terms of a few milliseconds. So what is the maximum delay that can be generated by the timer in each mode? So generally it is limited. So let us take the example of a crystal oscillator with 11 megahertz. So the T that you can get is that 11 megahertz divided by 12 is your timer clock. That 1 by F of that gives me around 1.085 microseconds. This is the largest time delay possible. So if we make for the largest time delay possible, THTL is equal to 0.0. To get the largest delay, we had to make TLTH equal to 0.0. So they have the maximum count from 0.0 to FFF, and then they roll over to 0. So the maximum count is 65,536 states. And that multiplied with each timer clock, time period is 1.085 microseconds. So multiply by 1.085 microseconds, so you get 71.1 milliseconds. So whenever I generate a square wave or whatever, the largest delay that I can get, the largest time delay that I can generate is around 71.1 a millisecond. This is in mode 1. So for mode 0, for mode 0, it is 13 bit. So for 13 means it is 2 power 13. 2 power 13 is 1 FFF. And that once again gives me 8 milliseconds. So when I go to mode 0, the maximum delay that I can get is 8 milliseconds. Mode 1, the maximum delay that I can get is 71 milliseconds. It's a 16-bit timer, so I get 71 milliseconds in mode 1. And in mode 0, I get 8 milliseconds for the same crystal frequencies. So to get higher delays, what we can do is, suppose I'm using mode 0 and I need 16 milliseconds. What do? I repeat 8 milliseconds twice. So instead of 8 milliseconds, I get 16 milliseconds. Similarly, if you want to get a delay of 2 seconds, you can 2 seconds, not 2 milliseconds, 2 seconds. What we can do, one option, you can generate a delay of 5 milliseconds and multiply this 5 milliseconds 400 times. So 5 milliseconds, when I multiply it by 400 times, you get 2 seconds. So you keep running the timer 400 times. Each time it is generating 5 milliseconds. 400 times it generates 5 milliseconds, the total time delay that is generated is 2 seconds. So any amount of delay you can get. So if you want 1 second, 5 seconds, etc. These are large time delays. To get the large time delays, in every mode, you have a maximum delay. So what is the maximum delay possible in mode 1? 71 milliseconds. The maximum delay you can get in mode 0, that's a 13-bit timer, is 8 milliseconds. It's 8 milliseconds. So if you want something in seconds, a delay in seconds, what we can do is we can choose an appropriate delay. Let us say 5 milliseconds. That you multiply by 400 times, you get 2 seconds. Suppose I take 10 milliseconds. Then to get 2 seconds, I have to multiply it by 200 times and so on. So this is one more example wherein I'm toggling the pin, port pin 1.5 every 1 second. So as soon as you go to 1 second, this is quite large delay. Use timer in mode 1. And as we have seen, the maximum delay from timer 1 in mode 1 is 71 milliseconds. So we repeat it 14 times. The 71 milliseconds, you repeat it 14 times to get 1 second delay. So the program code for this is this. T mode is 1.0. So 1.0 means timer 1, mode 1. And then you have to repeat it 4 times. So I'll use a register, a general purpose register R0, to behave as a counter, so that I needed to count how many times? 14 times. So mu R naught with 14. So complement, CPLS complement port pin 1.5, because you're going to toggle it. Toggle means complementing it or generating a square wave. All of them are one and the same. So CPL 1.5. Then move TL1 with 00 and TH1 with 00. This is the maximum delay that is possible. Start the timer. Wait till the timer overflows. Then stop the timer. Stop clear TR1. Then clear the timer flag to enable this. And then decrement R0. So R0 was 14 times. One time the timer runs, 71 milliseconds it has generated. Now I need a delay of 1 second. So it repeated 14 times. Put that 14 into a counter, that is your register R0, and then decrement, DJNZ, decrement R0, jump on not 0 to again 2. So I'm going to jump it again here. Again, I'm reloading TL1 and TH1 00. Actually, you can skip this because from FFF, TL1 and TH1 will roll over to 000. So you no need to actually initialize these timers as the timer overflows to 000 from FFF. So once again, start, then keep decrementing the R0. And once 14 times are over, you SJMP again from the beginning for the next 1 second delay. Again, load R0 with 14, complement the pin, a high is made low. Then 14 times you repeat 71 milliseconds so that you get approximately 1 second delay. So when I repeat 71.1 milliseconds 14 times, the delay I'm getting is 0.99954 seconds. It is not exactly 1 second. Rather, it is around 0.9944 seconds. So to get exactly 1 second, to generate exactly 1 second, so we can use something like 1 divided by 20. So we get 0.05. So we need to get around 50 milliseconds. So instead of 71 milliseconds, I can program the timer to generate 50 milliseconds, and that 50 milliseconds repeated 20 times. So 50 milli repeated 20 gives me exactly 1. 50 repeated by 20 gives me exactly 1. And remember that 50 milliseconds is less than 71.1 milliseconds. So 50 milliseconds is less than the maximum delay possible. The maximum delay possible for mode 1 is 71 milliseconds. So here I'm going to take one whole integer number, which is less than 71. Let us say 50. 50 milli multiplied by 20 gives me 1 second directly. So this is another example wherein you're going to use timer 1 and mode 2. And we are going to toggle all the bits continuously for 50 milliseconds. So what is the maximum possible delay in mode 2? Remember, mode 2 is an 8-bit timer. So the maximum delay in mode 2 is something like 276.6 microseconds. So it is 276.6 microseconds. So this is less than 1 millisecond. We need 50 milliseconds. So out of this 276 microseconds, let us make it as a whole number. Let us say it is 250 microseconds or 0.25 milliseconds. So instead of 0.276 milliseconds, I'll take 0.25 milliseconds. And this 0.25 milliseconds, I'll multiply it by 200 times. 0.25 milliseconds, multiply it by 200 times to get 50 milliseconds. So this is one example of mode 2. Mode 2 is auto reload. We have just seen mode 2 is auto reload. And with this auto reload, we have to generate 50 milliseconds continuously. Every 50 milliseconds, I'm toggling the bits of P2, port P2. But to toggle the bits, I need 50 milliseconds. But the maximum delay possible in mode 2 is something like 276 microseconds or 0.276 milliseconds. So this 0.276 milliseconds, I'll make it as a whole number. That whole number, let me say it is around 0.25 milliseconds. And that 0.25 milliseconds, I'm multiplying it by 200 times to get the 50 millisecond delay. And this is another example wherein the program has given, and you're going to find the frequency of the square wave that is generated on the pin. So first, let us check what is moved into TMOD. What is moved into TMOD 2? So when I expand this 2, I'll get 4 zeros, then 0010. So the 0010 specifies it is timer 0, and mode 2 auto reload. And mode TH 0 equal to 0. That means the max count is in mode 2. Then I have a register here that is loading 250 times, and I'm complementing the port 1. And I'm going to jump again. And in this delay subroutine, I'm starting the timer, set B TR0, timer 0. Then you're waiting till the timer rolls over. Then stop the timer, that is clear TR0. And then you're also clear the TF0 for this. And now you're going to check the counter, decrement. And the counter, I made it as 250. The register, the general purpose register R5. So you're decrementing it. And if it is non-zero, again, you're going back to the delay. So when you're starting the timer, waiting till it overflows, etc. And what about the timer? The timer is loaded with the initial count TH equal to 00. So it's a maximum value. So what is the square wave that can have? So the maximum count it can count is 256. And what about the timer clock? The timer clock is assuming it is, here they have not given the XTAL, the crystal frequency. Assuming the crystal frequency is 11.0592 megahertz divided by 12, and it gives me 1.085 microseconds. So this 1.085 microseconds is multiplied by 256. Why is it multiplied by 256? Because the maximum count, the TH0 initial value is 00, and it's an 8-bit timer. So it will count up to FF. And this is repeated, 250 times by this register R5. This is register, this is for one T on. Okay, and before I complement CPL. CPL is complementing the bit. So before complementing the bit, one time, the complete delay that is generated is R5 is 250. 250 times the counter. Here the initial value is 0. So the maximum count possible is 256 multiplied by the timer clock. The timer clock is 1.085 microseconds. But this is only for T on. Similarly, I have for T off. So the total T equal to T on plus T off. So T on plus T off is 2 times this. So that gives me around 138.88 milliseconds. And divide 1 by T, that gives me the frequency of 72 hertz. It gives me a frequency of 72 hertz. So the next we're talking about is NALP tip. Have the time. The next that we are talking about is the ALP tip. Every time we have to load the initial value, especially in mode 2, we have to do FF minus the initial value plus 1. Instead of this, I can move the count directly, move TH1 hash minus N. So all these examples you could have seen, when we have to generate the initial value. So this is when you have to generate the initial value, we are finding the count N. After finding the count N, we are making 256 minus N. Instead of having this extra step of 256 minus N and loading A4, I can enter directly minus 92. So this is your minus N. So you can enter minus 92 directly. So what we can do, we can enter minus 92 directly. So that is one ALP tip wherein we can in the assembler. For example, if I load move TH1 hash minus 48. So this gives me something like FF minus 48, and that converted into hexadecimal, it gives me D0. And this is minus 48H. There is a difference between, this is decimal 48, this is hexadecimal. And once again, FF minus 48 in hexadecimal gives me some value that you convert it into, once again, hexadecimal, it is B8. So what's the advantage of this ALP? In the assembler, I can enter minus n directly. You need not have to compute ff minus n and load it into the registers. The register is TH1 or TH0. Instead of loading the ff 256 minus n, I can directly take the n that is counted and load that minus n into TH1 and TH0. The assembler will convert it. Then the C and ALP. Till now, we are talking about only ALP program. And suppose we want a C program, corresponding C program. And the syllabus says assembly level language programming for pulse or the square wave on mode 1 and mode 2. But this is 8051 is there from a long time. And if the question paper setter asks you to write it in C program, and you have gone prepared only with ALP, but writing it in C is easy. So this is a ALP program which we have seen, wherein we have move TMOD with 00, then move R0 with 14, then CPL, and so on. This is for generating a square wave in mode 2. For generating a square wave, then wherein we have TL0 with 0T, TH0 with 33, this is a square wave. And start the timer, stop, then clear the timer, stop the timer, then clear the TF0, and then again jump back to R0, wherein we are complementing the bit. So whenever you have complement, it's toggling, that's a square wave. So corresponding C program, how do you start the C program? Always you should have hash include register 51.h so that it recognizes the pin P2.3. It also recognizes TL0, TMOD, TH0. To recognize all this, I have to include the registers of 51. So include register 51.h. And I can use one variable name, my pin. Instead of every time typing P2 cap 3, okay, instead of typing everything, I can give a variable name. That variable name will be my pin. So this is variable my pin. And what is a variable? Is it a character, integer, or something? No, it's a bit. So it is a bit, and P2.3 is a special bit. So this is in SFR, special function register. So I have to call this variable as a S bit. So the variable here is representing a special bit. That is, it is representing a bit in a SFR. So the SFR is port 2. P2 is SFR, and in this port 2, one bit. Which bit it is? The third bit. P2 cap 3. So P2 cap 3 is a bit, and for this I'm assigning a variable name. So what is a variable name that I'm assigning? My pin. My pin represents the port pin P2 and cap 3. And what is this my pin? My pin is representing a bit. So it is S bit. And this bit is not in the bit addressable area. It's not in the bit addressable area. Rather, this is in a SFR, bit addressable SFR. SFR is special function register. So instead of just saying bit my pin, I'll say it as S bit. So it is not in bit addressable area. So you have to use the C program, S bit my pin. Then once again, void main, that's a generic one. Then I use a counter. Previously here we are using R0, general purpose register, as a counter. So I can use any integer here, any character I. So this is a variable I, this is behaving as a counter. So unsigned char I, then while one. So it's a continuous one, so while one. We need a CPL P2.3, that is your toggling. My pin equal to toggle. Okay, and this is your toggle my pin. So if my pin is 1, it will become 0 and vice versa. And this is a for loop. For I equal to 0, I less than 14, I plus plus. Remember, we are loading move R0 with hash 14. And in the end, decrement jump on need 0, R0 to again 2. So this is a for loop. So in this for loop, for I equal to 0, I less than 14, I plus plus. What am I doing? I'm making T mod equal to 00, and TL0 equal to 0T. So once again, T mod is 00, that is timer 0 and mode 0. And the initial value in TL0 and TH0. TL0 is 0D, TH0 is 33, same thing. Here we are using move instruction. Here in C program, I'm directly writing TL0 is equal to 0x0d. Here I'm moving it as hash. Hash specifies it is immediate value. If I don't have hash, this will be a memory address. So direct memory addressing. But here I put hash. Hash specifies its immediate value. So the immediate value is 0x. X specifies it is hexadecimal value. 0x0d is moved into TL0. Similarly, 0x33. So it's also 33h. So if I don't want, if I have just 33, hash 33, I have to skip 0x. Directly 33, I have to move to TH. So what does the 0x in C specify? The 0x in C program specifies it is hexadecimal value. So 0x0d is moved into TL0. TL0 is equal to 0x0d. TH0 is equal to 0x33. Then TR0 equal to 1. Start the timer. Then while TF00 equal to 0. That means you keep waiting as long as TF0 is equal to 0. So here jump on node 0, TF0 to wait. So you're waiting here. So as long as TF0 equal to 0, you are here. So you don't come out of this while loop. So this while function, it will be here. Then once it comes out, you have to clear TR0. TR0 is 0, clear TF0, TF0 equal to 0. Then close the for loop. So this is after TF0, you have to go back here. So the DJNZ again 2, wherein once again I load the TL0, TH0. In fact, the TMOD, you can push it outside the for loop. TMOD is not needed here. Only initializing TL0 and TH0 is sufficient. Start, wait till it becomes 0, stop the timer, clear the timer flag, and again you go back. This is a for loop. This will be done 14 times. And after I do 14 times and with this, then I come out of this and then I go here wherein my pin will be toggled. My pin equal to, you're toggling the my pin. That is, you're complementing CPL. So this is the end of the while. And this is finally the end of the main. So that's your end of your main. Then we come to the counter application. So till now we were talking about this timer peripheral in timer mode. So there is something like C/TBAR where it can be used in counter mode. What do you mean by counter and what are the applications of the counter? So in all those above programs, C/TBAR equal to 0. So if I say C/TBAR equal to 0, it is taking the crystal frequency. So the clock from the crystal frequency is divided by 12 and it is given. Instead of the clock, internal clock, I can give a square wave from externally, or I can connect a signal generator at one of the pins. So there's two special pins. One is T0 and T1. T0 is for timer 0 and T1 is for timer 1. The T0 is pin 3.4. That is port 3 and the fourth pin, or the fifth pin rather, if I have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So port 3.4 will act as the T0 pin. This is also the special name for this is T0. So the pulses, whatever are given at this pin, it will act as a clock input to the timer register. And once again, this TH0, TL0, timer 0, can act in all the modes, mode 0, mode 1, mode 2. And then we have TR0 to start and stop the timer. And when it overflows, you have the overflow flag TF0. Suppose I'm using timer 1. Suppose I'm using timer 1. This will become TH1 and TL1. And this is also TF1. This is TR1. The pulses, the external pulses now should be given at pin 3.5. So instead of pin 3.4, it should be given at pin 3.5, external pin. So there are two clock sources, one at pin 3.4 for timer 0, another at pin external pin 3.5, that's the port 3.5, that pin will act as the clock for timer 1. This is in counter mode. So this is the one, this is a port pin, the function, what is the name for this? This is P3.4 T0. The pin number is 14 and this is a pin number 15. The name of this is T1. This is timer counter 1 external input. And the TMOD. In the TMOD, you have to do certain modification. The TMOD is an 8-bit register. Lower 4 bits are for timer 0, upper 4 bits are for timer 1. So in these 4 bits, 2 bits are for mode, and the mode can be anything, mode 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0. And you are talking about now C slash T bar. The C slash T bar should be equal to 1. If I'm using it in the counter mode, the clock pulses. The clock pulses for timer 0 are given at port 3.4. And similarly, timer 1. If I'm making C slash T bar equal to 1, C slash T bar equal to 1, the clock pulses should be given at pin 3.5. It should be given at pin 3.5. So this is one example wherein we can actually use pins. Which are the pins? T0 pin and T1 pin. So if I can't remember 3.4, then it's easier to remember T0, timer 0, T0. And I need not have to remember P3.5. I can remember T1 directly. T1 is a clock input at which is given to the timer 1. Then what are the application of this counter mode of operation? It has many applications. It can be used to count the number of people entering a stadium or something, the number of objects moving on a conveyor belt, the number of wheel rotations, or if it is in pharmaceutical company, the number of pills, tablets falling into a bottle, etc. So how do you count this routine values and all? So let us say you have a setup, you need a hardware setup. So in this hardware setup, this is a hardware setup used to count the objects or people. One side I have an LED and the other side I have a photo detector, and the output of the photo detector is given to the counter. So here I'm generating the clock pulses. Here you're generating the clock pulses. And the object or people's path is this. So how does this work? So this is your LED. So one time, assume that these are the people who are entering the arch. And one side of the arch, you have an LED. One side of the arch, you have an LED. On the other side, you have a photo detector. So when no one passes through the entrance, no one is passing through the entrance, there is no obstacle. There is no obstacle. The LED's output, the light output, will completely fall on the photo detector, and the photo detector will give me a high signal. So it will be a high pulse. When there is no obstacle or no object or no person moving in between the LED and the photo detector, the LED light will completely fall on the photo detector, and the photo detector will become high, and it will give me continuous high. So as soon as a person passes through the entrance, the LED's output will be cut off. So the LED's output will be cut off, and the photo detector will give me a low. And the photo detector will be giving me a low. And as soon as it passes, once again, the person passes, once again, the LED light will fall on the photo detector and it will give me a high. So for every person, there is a high to low transition. And after the person passes out, again, it will go back to high. So it's as if it's a clock pulse. In other words, a pulse is generated for every person. And these pulses, if they are fed to a counter and they are being counted, then you can count at the end of a particular time. You can also check how many people have passed through the entrance. The count accumulated in the counter can be displayed to find out how many objects have passed or how many people have passed the entrance. So what is the setup? One side you have LED, the other side the photo detector, and one pulse will be generated for every person that is passing through the path. You're counting the pulses will give me the number of people. So this is one example wherein at the external pin T1, that is P3.5, you're giving a clock pulse directly from a signal generator, and the clock pulse that is being given is a 1 hertz external clock. And you are going to write a C program in counter 2 mode 2 to count it up. And so you're feeding it to T1, and we are using the mode 2, timer 1. T1 implies it is timer 1, and you are using it in mode 2. And we are going to count it up. So as soon as the clock pulses are being fed, the timer will keep counting. That timer is now acting as a counter. The timer is acting as a counter. It is not counting the internal clock pulses. Rather, it is counting the clock that is being given, the external clock that is being fed to pin T1. and you are going to start the count at 00, and you are going to display the same on the port P1. Whatever the TL1 count is there, it will display on P1. One advantage, this is the setup. So the input clock pulses to be counted are given at pin 3.5. And whatever the count is there, the TL1 count is displayed at P1 port. So the P1 will be displayed the TL1 count. Suppose you have an LCD here, the LCD may display what is the value. And since it's a 1 hertz external clock, it is count, what is the time? T is 1 by 1 of F, so 1 by 1 hertz is 1 second. So generally it is timing this. So let us look at the T mod. The T mod is 060. How did you get the T mod? I'm using timer 1. So timer 0 is don't care. So the last 4 bits can be 000. And in timer 1, the mode that I'm using is mode 2. So it is 10. So M0, M1 are 10. And I'm using in counter mode. So the C/T bar is 1. I'm not using gate, that I'm not using external control. So the gate is 0. So when I expand it, 0110, the 0110 is 6. And these are all 4 zeros. The timer 0 is not being registered. So this is 0. So the T mod specifies timer 1, mode 2, and in counter mode of operation. Why counter mode of operation? It has to count the pulses that are given at the pin 3.5. The pin 3.5 is also has a special name. The special name is T1. The clock input is T1. So here, once again, this is a thing that is the TR1. The TR1 will start, and this is mode 2. This is once again the schematic setup. And in mode 2, it is auto reload. As you know, mode 2 is auto reload. Whatever TH1 is there, it will be automatically reloaded into T1 when it overflows. The TR1 will control the start and stop of the timer. And you are getting the clock pulses. The clock pulses are given at the input pin 3.5. And C/T bar equal to 1, indicating it's a counter mode. That is your external clock. So here, once again, the TL1, the start the count at 0, mode 2. And if you're starting the count at 0, TH1 equal to 00. So this is your regular one. This is timer mode. In timer mode, you're giving the crystal frequency. Can you see? This is the crystal frequency. And in external input, that is in counter mode. In counter mode, we are giving it at the pin. We are giving at the pin 3.5. So the rest of this is same. TR, then TL, TH, auto reload, and TF. The only difference is the clock source. So in counter mode, the clock source is given at an external clock, at an external input. External clock is given at the input pin point, which is a pin point 3.5 for timer 1. If it is in timer mode, you are using the crystal frequency divided by 12. This is timer mode. And what mode is this? This is external. Be careful with the difference. So now here, for timer mode, we have to specify the crystal frequency. We used to say XTAL equal to 22 megahertz, XTAL equal to 11.0592 megahertz, and so on. Here we have to talk about the frequency of the external input that is given at pin 3.5. So this is a program wherein you have generated it. We have given the solution. This is in C. I include the registers. Then S bit T1 is P3 cap 5. Then void main. T1 equal to 1. Make the pin as input pin so that you can give the external clock here. So at T1 equal to 1, we have to set it in input mode. This is the clock at which you have to set it at input mode. Then T mod is 60, we have seen. This is timer 1 in mode 2. So T mod is 60, that is timer 1 in mode 2. Then TH1 equal to 0. Initial count is reloaded into TL1 because it is mode 2. Initial count is reloaded into TL1 after 256, that is FF counts. Then while 1. So this is done continuously. So this is do while. While 1 is continuous loop. So this while 1 is continuous live. And apart from this while 1, you also have a do while. So you have a this is your do while loop. Be careful. So this portion is do while. And what do you mean by do while? So initially, as long as TF1 equal to 0, 0, as long as TF1 equal to 0, 0, what do? You're making TR1, you're starting the timer. Then P1 equal to TL1, you're going to display the value. Whatever P1 value is there, the port 1, on the port 1, the TL, the accumulated value is displayed. So as long as the timer doesn't become rollover from FF to 0, 0, what will happen? The TL is counting, the timer low is counting. What is it counting? It is for every input clock of 1 hertz, for every input of 1 hertz, TL1 is becoming 0, 0, then it is becoming 0, 1, 0, 2, and so on. Every time what 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 2 is sent to port 1, P1. It is sent to port 1, P1. And all this time, the TR1 is 1. That is, the timer is enabled. The timer is enabled continuously. And you can actually bring it outside the loop. And the TL1 value is put to P1. As soon as TL1 changes, when does TL1 change? When the external clock is increased. So when the external clock is increased, it will change. And that changed value is displayed continuously. The changed value is displayed continuously. And once TF1 becomes 1, that is once the timer overflows, what are we doing? With TR1 equal to 0, we are stopping the timer. You're stopping the timer. Again, TF, you're clearing so that you can enable once again. And again, you go back to this. So the end of while one, again, you go back here. From here, you go back. Again, you start the timer, keep displaying. So what is displayed at port 1? 0 to FF. And again, back from 0 to FF. This is displayed continuously. So this one actually does all of this program. So now we have what is known as the 1 hertz external clock, wherein we are being fed to the pin T1, and that value, the whichever is being counted, we are displaying at the port P1. So this is one program in counter. So this is one more example, 1 hertz, same 1 hertz clock being fed to port 1, but now this is mode 1. Previously it was mode 2. Previously, it was mode 2, 8-bit auto reload. So here, this is mode 1, 16-bit. And the 16-bit TL0 and TH0 part. The TL0 part is displayed at P1. The TH0 part is displayed at P2. Once again, here you have the same input clock pulses. And you're displaying the states on this. So once again, hash include registers, S-bit. Then make this as input pin, but here we are talking about timer 0. Previous example, we were talking about timer 1. So this is timer 0. So T0 is a clock pin. T0 equal to 1. Then the T mod is 05. So this is counter 0, mode 1. And the TL0 is the initial value. So TL0 equal to 00, TH0. So that's, it has a maximum count. Once again, you have while 1. Start, this is once again a do while loop. So on P1 we are sending TL0, on P2 we are sending TH0. Do this continuously as long as TF equal to 0, 0. Do this continuously. Once the TF0 becomes 1, what do? You stop the timer, then you clear the TF0 back to 0. Then this is end of while loop. Go back here, continuously do this, and end of main. So only small change here where we are reloading the initial value and we are waiting for the display. So this is a display. Read the program carefully, read the question carefully, and the program will be almost the same, only with slight changes to specify the in specification. And this is your ALP, wherein the input clock is being fed and the TL0, TH0 are displayed at P1, P2. So T mod, can you see here, T mod is 05. So T mod is 05, set B T naught, that is timer 1 is started, sorry, timer 0 is started. So make the T0 as input pin so that you can enable the timer. And then the initial count, TL0, TH0, start the counter, TR0, then display TL0 on P1. So if I have to display TL0 on P1, I cannot move TL0 to P1 directly. Move the TL0 to accumulator A. From accumulator A, you bring it to P1. Similarly, TH0 to A, and from A to back to PL2. And again, jump on no borrow to back. You keep checking TF0. As long as TF0 is not equal to 1, it's not equal to 1. That means TF0 is still 0. Maximum count has not reached. So you go to back here where you keep displaying the TL0, TH0 part. Once TF0 becomes 1, that is, it has finished FFF and it is rolling. Right? So stop the timer, clear the TF0. And SJM back again, where you start the timer again, and you redo the whole thing. So when I have to use it as a down counter, this is one more example. To implement a down counter, it is very simple. Complement the count value and display. For example, up counter, all the timers are up counters. They're counting from 00 to FF. So to implement it as a down counter, what we have to do, that 00 to FF, if I complement, it becomes FF. 00 becomes FF and FF becomes 00. So as the counter counts from 0 to FF, and if I'm displaying, you're displaying the complemented value, then it looks as if I'm displaying FF to 00. It looks as if I've implemented a down counter. If once again, the initial value is 20H, then the display on this, instead of 20H to FF, that's a counter value. What will be displayed on port 1? The complement of 20H is DF. From DF to 00, it will down count. And how do you implement the complement? You use this tilde symbol. You can see this tilde symbol. This tilde symbol is for down counting. So instead of saying P1 equal to TL1, in this example, P1 equal to TL0, P2 equal to TH0. So this P1 equal to TL1 and P2 equal to TH0 are replaced by the tilde symbol. So that is complement TL1 and display on the port pins. Complement TL1 and display on the port pins. So this will behave as a down counter. This will behave as a down counter. So this is one more example. Now we have to display the seconds and minutes. Once again, we are giving an external clock. The external clock is of 1 hertz. So the time duration is of 1 seconds. So every 1 second, if it is incrementing, automatically it can behave as a clock. It can display the seconds and the minutes. But to display on seconds, you have 60 seconds. After 60 seconds, you have to increment the minutes counter. So you need a seconds counter, you need a minutes counter. So the count value will be from 00 to FF. So the count value will be from 00 to FF. So the maximum count value is 255, and you have to convert it. So the 255 by 60, I get a quotient of 4. So it will be 4 minutes, and the remainder is 15 seconds. So the maximum value in mode 2. Even if I give a 1 hertz, at this point, I'm giving a 1 hertz external clock. That is, I'm getting a 1 pulse every 1 second. And that is being accumulated on TL0. And the TL0 value is displayed. The TL0 value is the counter will become 00, 01, 02, and so on. I need it in terms of seconds and minutes. So whatever the accumulated value in TL0 is there, you divide it by 60. So when I divide it by 60, whatever quotient I get, that will be the minutes. And the remainder will be the seconds. Whatever is remaining will be the seconds. So this is a small program. Tmod is 6, that is counter 0 in mode 2. And the set B T0. So T0 is a clock input, external clock input. You have to make it as an input pin. Then initial count is 00. Start the timer. Get the timer value TL0 into accumulator A, move B with 60 because I have to divide it by 60 and use div AB. So when I do division, A will be having the quotient, which is the minutes, and B will be having the remainder. The remainder is nothing but the seconds. And now you display the minutes at port 2. Then again, bring B to A and display it at port 1. That will be the displaying the seconds. Once again, you keep doing this as long as the TF0 equal to 0. That is, as long as the timer is not overflowed. The timer has overflowed, clear the TR0, clear the TF0, and SJMP repeat. Keep repeating it. So this is a small program wherein I'm displaying the seconds and minutes. But one disadvantage is it's in mode 2 where the maximum count is 256. So I can display a maximum of only 4 minutes and 15 seconds. So if I want it much higher, and you want it much higher, and I have to display it on LCD. And if I have to display on LCD, I have to convert the BCD value to ASCII. You have to convert a BCD value to ASCII. And this is a portion taken from your textbook. Here at T0, I'm feeding the 1 hertz pin, and I'm sending the data to LCD. But before you send the data to LCD, whatever number you have to convert it into ASCII and send it to LCD. So first you have the LCD setup, then the T mode is counter 0, mode 2. So this is 1 0. So 1 0 is mode 2. This is 1. This is 1 is the counter mode. And I'm using the lower 4 bits. The lower 4 bits specifies timer 0. Then instead of dividing by 60, in the previous program, I was dividing by 60. Rather, I count only 60 seconds. So move TH0 equal to hash minus 60. You have it as minus 60. And then we can... So instead of dividing by 60 every time, I can start the initial value as minus 60. That is, instead of saying FF minus 60, remember we had just given the ALP tip, I can enter N directly. To enter N directly, I give minus N. So minus N here is minus 60. So the timer here will count 60, and after it counts 60, it will overflow. So every time it is counting 60, then automatically I'll get the minutes. So you set the timer, start the timer, and then move AL with TL0. And once you start the timer, the TH0 value, the initial value will be in the TL0. And you have the conversion, and you call the display, and you go back again. So the TL0 value will have a copy of the count. It will have a copy of the count. And in the textbook, they have written the copy of the count, which has to be displayed. So now, for example, let us say TL0 is having something like FD. TL0 has counted to FD. So TL0, as you know, it can count up to FF. So if TL0 is FD, I have to display 253. So to display 253, what do? You have to convert. This is a small program where you're converting the binary to ASCII. So to convert the binary to ASCII, what do? I take move B with 10 and div AB. So before you come back here, you can see that A is having the TL0 value. So A is having the TL0 value. What is A containing? A is containing the TL0 value. And once A is containing, so this is A is containing the TL0 value. And then you're going to the counter. So you're going to the counter. So when you're going to the counter, in the counter, the A value is divided by 10. Assume A is TL0 is FD, that is 253. So once you do the divide A by B, B is having 10. So your B is having 10. So you have B equal to 10. And once you divide it by 10, div AB, what does this div AB do? A will have the quotient, B will have the remainder. The remainder is the lowest digit. The lowest digit is 3, and that you store it in R2. So move B with R2. So what will be having? B will be having R2. R2 will be the lowest digit. Okay, next what you do is, again you move B with 10. Again, this is second time. And we have already stored 3 in 2. So now what is A containing? A is containing the quotient. The quotient is 25 in BCD. So once again, you move B with 10. Once again, you move with B with 10. Do this div B again. So move B with 10 again. So 25 by 10. So 25 by 10, A will be having 2. B will be having 5. So B will be having 5. So A will be the MSD. Finally, A will having the most significant digit. Out of 253, here A is having 2. So after this div instruction, A will be having this 2. So A will be having this 2. I can display this 2 directly. Since it is in BCD and I have to display this, I have to convert it into ASCII. To convert it into ASCII, just add 30. Or AL with 30. So 2 will become 32H, and I can, that's an ASCII value of 2, and I can display that directly. Then again, save this into R4, and then again, take B to A. So B will be having the second digit. So now we are here, B will be having the second digit. This is your second digit. And then once again that you move it to A, add with 30. So the second digit also is converted into ASCII. Then what is remaining out of this 253? We have already finished 2 and 5. Only 3 is left. 3 we had already got here. Okay, so here we had already got 3. So in R2 we had this 3. So bring that back, that 3. Bring this 3 back here. So bring this 3 back here. Add with 30 and return it. So at the end of the day, what we'll have, all this 253 is converted into the ASCII value. You're separating out. So suppose I have FD. You're going to convert this FD as 253 in decimal. So divided by 10, you get the last digit, the 3, B3. That is, you save it in 2. And again divide, and A will be having the quotient at this place, that is 25. A will contain with 25. Again make B with 10, div AB. Now A will have 2 and B will have the remainder 5. Then this 2 directly you put it as OR and you send. B you bring it to A and add again 30. That is, you're converting into ASCII and you're going to send. Then bring back R2. R2 was your 3, the lowest digit. To that you add 30 and again you send. So this was in your textbook, the last portion, where he has given one small example, that is 1 hertz frequency pulse is connected to pin T0, and let the initial value of the counter be minus 60, and he wants to display the counter 0 on an LCD. So if you have to display the counter value on an LCD, you have to convert it into ASCII. So to convert it into ASCII, he's dividing it by 10 and so on. So since it's in the textbook, your reference textbook, I took this program. But actually, there's no point in displaying 253, 254, 255. I can as well as divide it by 60 and display the minutes and the seconds. So this program needs little modification. Then we have one more way. So in all this instruction, we have said set B TR0, clear TR0. So everywhere, can you see this? Set B TR0, clear TR0. Set B means start the timer. Clear TR0 means stop the timer. So instead of using that instruction, this TR0 and TR1. So this TR0 or TR1 and also TF0, TF1. They are in TCON register. The TCON register is bit addressable register. So it's a bit addressable special purpose register. I can also say set B TCON.4. So this is D0, D1, D2, D3, D4. So what is TR0? TR0 is .4. So I can say set B TCON.4. Similarly, if I have to use TF0, so TF0 is this, that is TCON.5. Then TR1 is TCON.6 and TF1 is TCON.7. So generally we feel this is easier. Set B TR0, start the timer. clear TF0. That is, enable the timer again. TF0 would have rolled over to 1 when the timer overflows. You clear it. So instead of using your clear TF0, equivalent instruction is clear in TCON register. In TCON register, the dot fifth bit, this is your fifth bit, this is the zeroth bit, first bit, second bit, third bit, fourth bit, fifth bit. Fifth bit is TF0. So clear TCON dot five. This is one more way of specifying this. And these are some review questions, some 2-point questions. So if the who is providing the clock pulses, if C/T = 0, this is a timer. C/T = a timer mode. So the clock pulses are obtained from the crystal frequency, crystal xtal divided by 12. And if it is 1, it's a counter mode. If it is in counter mode, T0 is for timer 0, T1 is for timer 1, and they are from the pins 3.4 and 3.5. So next, if you have to allow P3.4 to be used as an input for this at T1, P3.4 is actually the input for T0. So if you have to use it, allow it as for a T1, then I have to use it in mode 3. Mode 3 we haven't covered, it's not in syllabus, we have covered only till mode 2. And what is the equivalent of the following instruction? SETB TCON.6. So SETB TCON.6. TCON.6 is nothing but TR1, and the equivalent instruction for this is SETB TR1. Instead of TCON.6, I can say TR1. So this finishes your complete review of your timers and counters. So the second part is the serial communication, which we will do in the next session. So we have taken around 3 sessions to cover the timers and counters in mode 1 and mode 2. And in both the examples, we are given for a pulse, a square wave, the application, the different registers, how do you enable the initial count, and so on. So thank you. We'll meet in the next class.